The following is a special presentation of Soul Cafe Radio, a September to remember, 20 years later. This presentation is being brought to you by Your Word Doctrine. See the information in the description.
Around the world today, and you see trouble and heartache on every side. But the Father says, don't worry, for I've called you by name and you are mine. So when the flames of affliction threaten to ravage your soul, when the mighty waves of strife threaten to wash over that old ship of Zion, remember that it won't be long. For Jesus said, friends, I'm gonna leave you now. But just as sure as I'm leaving you, I'm coming back to receive you. And when he comes again, this corruptible is going to put on incorruption. This mortal is going to put on immortality. For we shall be changed.
We shall be like him.
Welcome to Soul Cafe Radio, where we cater food for the mind and soul. Please join us this hour for uplifting music, messages, and more. And now to the RMG Studios in Miami Gardens, Florida, and your host, the Word Master.
Good morning, good afternoon, good evening. Wherever you are and whenever you're listening to this, you're tuned into Soul Cafe Radio, food for the mind and soul. Today we are in the last week of our mini focus on September 11th as we focus this September on a September to remember that takes us back all the way 20 years ago onto a very traumatic time in our nation's history. What did we learn and how did it change us and what are we doing after? Friends, today's message is an all-important one, knowing but not prepared. We shall delve into certain things that may grab your attention and just vie for all the different other questions that's raising your mind. But all important is, do you know stuff? But when it's time for that stuff that you know to be put into practice, are you going to be ready? Or are you allowing Satan and his agents to keep your mind focused on other things so that you are neglecting the needful preparation? If you had listened during our weekend presentations, you'd have known how important it is for the people of God to be getting ready at this time in our earth's history. So once again, welcome. Thank you for joining us. If you're listening live, please share the invitation to share the information so that others could join us and hear these things before it is too late. And I just want to say before we get into the message and into deep, very safe and happy Labor Day to those in the United States. And without further ado, please join me as we have a word of prayer. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, thank you so much for your loving kindness and your tender mercies. Thank you for being to us a God like no other. Oh Lord Jesus, I just want to thank you and praise you and give you the glory that you so richly deserve in our Father, as we get into the heart of this message, I pray that your Holy Spirit will indict our hearts, oh God. Father, please teach us what we need to learn at this time before it is too late for us. Help us to be ready, Lord God, and help us to get other people ready, I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. At this time, we'll break for songs and our station identification, and then we'll be back. Once you hear our theme song, Are You Ready for Jesus to Come?, you know that we're ready for our study for today, September to Remember, 20 years later, knowing but not prepared. Stay tuned.
The old rugged cross they took. Without hope, death has wrapped them in gloom. But at the side of a saint, there's rejoicing. For life can't be sealed in a tomb. Oh, and the old rugged cross made the difference in a life bound for heartache and defeat. I will praise him forever and ever for the cross made the difference for me. Yes, the cross made the difference for me. For
but I've heard
the
voice of my Savior.
That's the good part. Hallelujah.
Bidding
yes,
me still fight on.
Give you courage.
And he promised never to leave
me. He'll keep that
me.
Promise. Yes, he will.
Never to leave.
Never alone.
my Savior.
Savior.
Standing between.
That gives me joy. Hallelujah.
He stands.
Stands there.
To shield me from danger.
Yes, he do.
When
he
all.
Yes, sir.
My friends are gone.
He'll be with you, children. Yes, he will.
But he promised never.
He'll be right there.
To leave.
He'll keep that promise.
Me.
Yes, he will.
Never.
I almost forgot that it was a Monday, and as promised, we'll have new music that we haven't played in a while, played on the rotation. So here is Lionel Harris with I Miss My Time With You.
More than
miss my time with you. Those moments together, I need to be with you each day. And it hurts me when you say you're too busy, busy trying to serve me. But how can you serve me when you're speaking?
Are you ready to love? again His face. Can you look up and say, this is my Lord? Are you ready for Jesus to come?
That's the question on the floor today. Are you ready for Jesus to come? The answer, sadly, for many is that they know something is happening. They have learned something is getting ready to happen, but sadly, they won't be prepared. So before we get into the heart of our exercise for today, let's do a little mental exercise. For me, I could name quite a few world, quote unquote, world ending triggers. And so what I want you to do for me is, if you are a friend of mine on Facebook, you follow me on Facebook, on Twitter, whether it's in the messenger or on the timeline where the announcements are posted, you could answer this question. Or if you follow me on Spreaker or on the website, you could comment in the feedback section, the contact me section. The question is, what are some things that you remember either in your lifetime or shortly before that people thought that Christ was about to come, that the world was about to end? For me, it's, of course, seeing that this is the theme of our 2 week long program, 9/11, of course, 2001, and the year prior, year 2000. So those two, for me, are world-ending events that people thought that Christ was going to come. In fact, in both events, there was mass conversions. But, of course, we're here 20 and 21 years later, respectively. So, what is it that causes a person to be knowing all the facts, figures, dates, years, all the important numbers, and yet not be ready for the Lord to come? What is it? Let's go back to our scripture reading, which gives us not just a clue, but the answer. Matthew 24, verses 42 to 44, and then we'll go onwards from there. Watch therefore, for ye know not what hour your Lord doth come, reading from the King James. But know this, that if the good man of the house had known in what watch the thief would come, he would have watched and would not have suffered his house to be broken up. Therefore, be ye also ready, for in such an hour as ye think not, the Son of Man cometh. Who then is a faithful and wise servant, whom his Lord hath made ruler over his household, to give them meat in due season? Notice, blessed is that servant whom his Lord, when he comes, shall find so doing. So not only do we have a clue as to what we're supposed to be doing, getting ready so that we don't get caught off guard, we're supposed to be still doing what we were commissioned to do. So, as some of you probably already know, most of my audience, I should say anyway, I'm a Seventh-day Adventist, and Seventh-day Adventist young people, if anything else, are trained and prepared for the time ahead. They have a whole unit, well, actually two, if I'm being honest. In fact, you could actually say that the whole purpose of the young people department at the Seventh Adventist Church is to prepare the young people for the coming crisis. You got Pathfinders, you got the AYS Society, or AYM, and the Sabbath School sessions, all preparing the young people to go through the coming crisis. But it's one thing to have your head full of information, like it says in Matthew 24:42,
It's one thing to know, as the good man of the house, that the thief's usual routine is to come around 10 to midnight and to be ready at a time. But it's another thing to know that and not preparing. You know, you're looking out at 6 to 9 when the hours are 10 to midnight. So too is the majority of people who are professing to be watchers. A major world event hits, and they say, surely this is it. In fact, the one that we're living through right now, there are many conversions because of the COVID-19 crisis, and many people are using the COVID-19 crisis as a catalyst for the return of Christ. And so Satan would have people's minds diverted towards more of the watching, more of the looking, more of the gathering information, facts, figures, days, years. They calculate themselves into frenzy and so on. You see, friends, the thing is, the way that we don't get caught off guard is by being about our Father's business. It's about doing what He has called us to do on a continual basis, serving the Lord until He comes. The question in the song that we just heard as our theme song for today, are you ready for Jesus to come? In your head, you may be saying yes, but at the end of the day, it is heart work that matters. It is heart work that is needed. Are you ready for Jesus to come? Have you made a total surrender of yourself to Him? Is self becoming less and less until it's no more? Do you find yourself in a position where you're spending more time studying the Word of God to the exclusion of food, sleep, all these other worldly amusements, because you want to get closer to the truth as it is in Jesus, that you want the eyes of your understanding to be open? Do you find yourself loving to share the good news of the gospel? These are signs of your readiness, friends. But notice to what I was saying earlier, complacency sets in because you have a 9/11 followed by 20 years later. You have a Y2K followed by 21 years later. Friends, instead of these things being allowed to make us turn away from the path, the time that remained should have been enough so that we could be doing what we are supposed to be doing, and that is purifying our characters. Can I tell you how many people were disappointed after the end of supposedly world-ending events? I have one more for you, the year 2012. Even though many people weren't claiming that that was a world-ending year, according to the ancient minds, it was supposed to be. But because nothing really happened, they recalculated and said, well, it was actually a, you know the stories. And of course, the biggest thing that we have out there that the world, at least these United States, know is the atomic clock that's winding down. And even now, as we're speaking, it's saying that it's minutes to midnight, and we're talking about in the very, very low minutes. So the world is watching, but are they preparing? Church members are watching, but are they preparing? I'm reminded of a story that happened at the destruction of Jerusalem or shortly thereabouts. There was this man that was purported to be going around telling people that Jerusalem is about to be destroyed. Jerusalem is about to be destroyed. Jerusalem is about to be destroyed. Warning people to get ready so that they could avert the threatened danger. But you know what I read at the end of that account? That gentleman, that brother, suffered the fate that he was warning people about. He died in the destruction of Jerusalem. This being September, my mind cannot help but going back to September 18th, 1995, when I found out that my friend had died, was killed. I remember, I think it was 4 or 5 days later, at her funeral, where these young people stood up over her body and said, "I'm going to change." I remember the tears that were in many of those young persons' eyes when they said that this incident of this very young person losing her life triggered them to change their ways, and they're going to be better, and they're going to see her in the kingdom. I still remember the steady train of young people who walked up to that podium and with tears in their eyes confessed that they needed to change. In 2021, I wonder, and I can't help but wonder, how many of them are still preparing for the Lord to come. Has the intervening years caused them to lose sight of the Lord and lose sight of their promises? This was 95, and we are here, 2021. How many of you, even in this year, have said, "I'm going to be ready when Jesus comes"? My friends, I cannot stress enough the point that we can know all that there is to know and still not be ready. Remember when I said that Adventist young people were some of the most trained to be ready for the coming crisis? I can remember on Sabbath afternoons, sitting there after we had lunch and listening to this one particular lady sharing with us what she knew about the coming crisis. And I was part scared, part intrigued. But what I did say was, "I'm going to be ready." And I thought that joining the Pathfinder, which is an equivalent of the Boy Scouts and Girl Scouts, joining that would help me to be ready. I thought that studying my Bible would help me to be ready. Remember what I said earlier? I thought a lot. But in all of that, the one ingredient, the one missing ingredient that Jesus talked about, it just wasn't there. He said to the Pharisees, the scribes, the intellects of his day, "You search the scriptures, for in them you think you have eternal life, but you will not come to me that you would have life." Isn't that interesting, friends? All day, all night, they were pouring over the scrolls that point to the Messiah. And yet when the Messiah was unseen, unlike Nicodemus, even though he came by night, unlike Nicodemus, they did not come. They spurned him, they denied him. Though thankfully the Bible says that there were many who believed, and after Pentecost, there were many, many more who joined the church. Thank God for that. But the point is, you could have so much head knowledge, you could know so much intellectually, and still not be prepared. Consider the fact that the Bible says, "Love one another as I have loved you." You could quote verses like that until the cows come home, just to turn a phrase. But someone comes up to you unexpectedly, you wasn't even expecting it, and say, "Brother, sister, I'm in a bind, I could really use whatever." And after you've just quoted those verses that you know off the top of your head, whether it was because you were teaching a lesson, or you were citing something, or you were showing some person, you know, what you memorized. But then, when it came time to put what you had learned into practice, it was a definite proof that you did not learn anything at all, because just based on the way that the person looked, just on looks alone, you dismissed that person. The Apostle James, I think it's the Apostle James, in his book, there's probably another James, the author of the book of James, had that to say in chapter 2, where he talked about some persons who have this mindset of rejecting people they consider less, but yet still, you're supposed to be loving God. So, therefore, preparation, my friends, is not just saying that I'm going to study my Bible, I'm going to pray, I'm going to witness. Preparation is transformation. Preparation is heart changing. Preparation is surrender. Preparation is a change of the entire life, the motive, the purposes, the entire being. The Apostle Paul is one individual, one Christian that we all look up to as the epitome of this change. And we aspire to be like that. Friends, let me just say this clearly, succinctly. You cannot be calling yourself ready for Jesus to come just because you sung the song that was played, "Are You Ready for Jesus to Come?" You cannot be preparing for Jesus to come just because you show up to church every week. You can't be calling yourself ready for Jesus to come just because wherever there's a Bible study, wherever there's a prayer meeting, wherever there's a body of people gathered together in the name of the Lord, and you find yourself there. Friends, as part of it, it helps. I'm not going to deny that. But Christ is not calling you to meetings and functions and events and all these things. He's calling you to his side. And even while outwardly you appear before men to be pious, good, holy, righteous, like Jesus would have pegged it, inwardly you're full of dead men's bones. Beloved, I'm not knocking you sharing and posting on Facebook and Instagram and Twitter and all these things. But in the midst of all that, let Jesus share with you. He has something, he has a message for you as well. It's not just you sharing messages, he has a message for you. And if you take time to listen, you know exactly what it is. Knowing, but not prepared. It's a sad thing, friends, it's a sad thing. You must even sadder, preparing, but not knowing. We'll talk about that on tomorrow's program. Preparing, but not knowing, takes you in a whole different direction. You want to be in tune for that one. Friends, I just want to invite you into a relationship with Jesus Christ right now. We've talked for this past half hour about the importance of being prepared. Again, to quote, if you guys are old enough to remember G.I. Joe, where it says, knowing is half the battle. It is. Knowing is half of the battle, half of the warfare. Because without the information, you will be able to be led to transformation. That's what the Bible says. That's what the apostle says. How will they know if they don't have a preacher? So the words, the information is vitally important. But we must put action to these words. We must put heart to the ideals that we espouse. You see, friends, I dare say, what would have been the point of me training every Sunday morning, me learning all those lessons in Sabbath school, and in the evening when we had different activities? What would be the point of all that if it doesn't lead to a complete and utter surrender to the King of Kings and Lord of Lords? Obviously, you know, it's futile. Friends, we're not minimizing the knowing part. I'm just saying that in all your studies, study to show yourself approved unto God, not unto men. Not to show, yes, I've read the Bible straight through this 2021 year, or I went to church and I spent all day in service, or a myriad of other things. I close with what Jesus himself said, because now we're leaving the part of knowing to actually doing and yet not prepared. They said, Lord, Lord. So they're even doing what the Bible says, that whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord, they're even doing that. But listen to what they say. We deserve access to your kingdom because we prophesied in your name cast out devils, and in your name done many wonderful works. Friends, they're saying that we have done the works. We have done it. The Bible says to the contrary, that it is God who wills and works in us according to his good pleasure. It's not we have done anything. And because they have not learned that lesson enough to be prepared with a better response than let us in because we did the work, rather than I surrender to whatever your will is for my life. You see, beloved, Jesus' response to them is one of the saddest responses, one of the saddest words of all scripture. They would have said, in your name, we did all of this. We did all of this for you, Lord. It was all about you. Jesus would have turned to them and said, I never knew you. Depart from me, you who work iniquity. But hold up. They just said that they work righteousness, cast out demons, prophesied, and did all these wonderful things in his name. You said, I never knew you. Why? Because they never took time to feed the hungry, clothe the naked, take in the homeless, visit those in prison. They've never taken the time to do the ugly work. They've never taken the time to do the inglorious jobs. It was always to be seen of men, friends, family, loved ones. As we close out our time today, I want to appeal to you in the name of Jesus and under his authority, not just to be knowers, not just to be hearers, but to be doers of that word also. Time is short, and just like September 11th, which many people came into unprepared, unawares, and were caught up, and now are no longer with us, this will be the reality of many, many, many people going forward. My beloved, I'm appealing to those of you who are straddling the fence, one foot in, one foot out, who say, I don't know when Christ is coming back, and so I'm just going to live my life. My life, there you go again, my life. Galatians 2:20 says to the contrary. But you say, I'm going to live my life. And then when I see things, you know, winding down, I'm going to come back in and give my life completely to the Lord. It can't and it won't work that way, my friends. So I say today, on this sixth day of September 2021, give your life to Jesus. Say yes to Jesus. So make a full surrender of yourself to him. And as the song is playing, I want you to commit yourself to the Lord, or to recommit yourself to the Lord. Listen.
Lord, you've touched my heart today. That is why I've come to pray. You see all I have inside, all the things I try to hide. Jesus, I believe that you are there, and you're listening to this sinner's prayer. Touch this broken heart and make it new. I believe in you. Please forgive me for my sin, all I've done and all I've been. Serving you forevermore, every day you'll be my Lord. Jesus, I believe that you are there, and you're listening to this
Friend of mine, if you prayed that prayer, you are officially a part of the family of God, and you can count yourself among all of us who have committed our lives in the month of September, have converted to the Lord's way in the month of September, and truly, this will be a September to remember. The year you gave your heart to Jesus, or the year you recommitted to the Lord. As we close off, friends, yes, like I said, September 11th caught many people off guard. It was a stunner to many people who weren't expecting it, and the ripple effects lasted for weeks and months after that. But you know what? There were those who were prepared, not like the people we're going to talk about in tomorrow's program, but they were prepared in heart and mind. They were focused on the Lord. They were keeping their eyes single to His glory, and in the final analysis, He was able to take hold of their lives and keep them through the crisis. And that is the same thing He's going to do for you, my friends. I want you to stay with me after our closing prayer, as I have a brief announcement to make. So stay tuned. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, thank you so much for your loving kindness and your tender mercies. Thank you for your kindness and your compassion. Oh, Heavenly Father, today I ask you, I appeal to you, I pray to you, O God, that you will please be with all of us as we prepare for the coming of Jesus. The songwriter asked us earlier, are we ready for Jesus to come? Lord, help us to be ready. Help us to put away all the things of this world that do not draw us to Jesus, but help us to draw ever closer to our loving Savior. Bless every person who listens, dear Lord God. Bless them abundantly and bless them, dear God, in the areas that they need to be blessed and touched and prayed over, dear God, and keep them according to your goodness and mercies, Lord. Father, I pray that you will continue to be with this program. May it be used to your name's praise, honor, and glory. And Heavenly Father, every person who gave their heart to you just now during that prayer song, I pray that you will indeed seal their decisions, not just for the years of time, but for eternity, I pray, in Jesus' name. Amen. Friend of mine, before I close out today, before I leave you, I just want to invite at least 10. Ideally, I'd love to have 12 of you who are listening to commit to donating $50 to this program. $50, and we can meet a major goal so that we can keep this program on the year for another year. $50 from 10 of you. And you could find how to donate in the description to this program. If you're listening from the Spreaker Player app, it's those three dots on the website. You can see it clearly there. It's the I think it says, and it's for the information about the program, and it's to the bottom of the description how you can donate. And if you follow me on Facebook, if you're my friend on Facebook, you can donate on Facebook. Again, the preferred way is PayPal and Cash App, but you could donate in other formats. If you have questions or concerns, do not hesitate to get in contact with me. The information is on the Soul Cafe page, on the page on the speaker platform, and on Facebook, you can reach out to me. Friend of mine, all of it is for the Lord's honor and glory, and it will be used to reach in people so that they could hear the message of salvation before it is too late. I appeal to you to partner with me so that the word of truth can go out. And you, my friends, you will benefit. Trust me, you're not gaining, you're winning. It's a win-win situation. I promise you, take God at His word and give cheerfully. If you can afford to give more, then I would appreciate it. And for those who do give the $50 and over, I promise you that you will be gifted if you supply your mailing address with something from one of our stores. So may God bless you abundantly as you prayerfully consider being a faithful ministry partner to this program. And then remember, as I said, tomorrow's program is entitled The Opposite, Preparing But Not Knowing. Plan to join us. Have a blessed day. And again, for those of you in the United States, happy Labor Day. Enjoy your day off.
Joining us today on Soul Cafe Radio. You've been listening to powerful music and messages for the mind and soul. Join us next time when we deliver more of the same, and remember to visit our website at www.soulcafeonline.org.